Good morning, happy Resurrection Sunday. Welcome to our ministry called Restoration Fellowship. This is our homepage, focusonthekingdom.org. If you'd like to find out who we are, what we're all about, just go here to the links, as you can see there, and we have many other websites. We also have a Focus on the Kingdom magazine sent out monthly to about 70 countries, that's 70, for more than 20 years now. We also have other websites there, as you can see, and the Restoration Fellowship is basically a hub, a network for you to fellowship with other like-minded Christians around the world. We have many people from Croatia, England, France, Asia, Australia, and as of this writing, we also have a YouTube channel that you can access when you click there, and there it is. And the YouTube channel has more than 2,000 videos. And as you can see there, 2.7 million views started in 2010. It only took us 11 years. And let's see, we have, where's the subscribers? Oh, there it is. We just passed the 10,000 mark subscribers. So thanks to everyone. You can see all the videos, playlists down here, many playlists. We probably have answered pretty much all questions that have come our way. Sir Anthony obviously has 60 plus years experience, six decades worth. So we sent out our 8 books. We have a book list here. So if you go up to the links, click on books, and you can purchase some of them on Amazon. For example, Sir Anthony's New Testament with Commentary. You can purchase a hardcover there, but you can also follow along online thanks to Lori. Thank you to Lori and her team there. And you can follow along with today's reading of Hebrews 8. And this is Sir Anthony's translation and footnotes. When you click there, look at that. Beautiful. So it has the verses and the commentary there. So thank you so much to Lori down there in Florida. And we have material really in 20 plus languages. So some of these books, booklets, you can see there, Russian, Chinese. Tracy, who's doing the youth lesson this morning, has a very vibrant Russian ministry. So we provide support for really everyone around the world. And people have also donated their time and efforts towards translations as well. So we thank them very much. So in God's grace, we are a clearinghouse, as Sir Anthony likes to call it, for truth seekers and finders all over the world. So thank you so much for watching, for following us, and thanks for being here. All right, so usually we do a Shema reading. So I'll bring up Sir Anthony. He'll recite the Shema. He will tell us why, and then he will open up with prayer. Good morning, Anthony.
Good morning, Carlos. Thank you for that very concise and succinct summary of what we do. I hadn't realized, and it's good to be reminded week by week by you of what is available out there in many languages. And so we are believers in the Shema. Shema is the Hebrew word for listen, pay attention, obey. And the first of all commandments, Jesus said, the superlatively great commandment, Jesus said now, whom we claim to follow, is found in Mark 12:29. Goes like this in the Hebrew. You find the Hebrew, of course, in Deuteronomy 6. Every Jew knows this. Every Christian ought to know it, but they're not paying attention to Jesus as they should. So it sounds like this in Hebrew, Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. And the word Echad means cardinal number one, not two, not three or more, number one. The Lord our God is one Lord, Kyrios Eisestin in Greek, and we're using the modern Greek pronunciation. That should be clear to the whole world, but it's not. So spend your time then on the internet trying to persuade people to believe first that God is one single person. And then, as we'll be commenting in our section on Hebrews today, Jesus is at the right hand of the Father. but he's not God. Rather, he's the Lord Messiah. We'll get to more of that in a moment, but thanks so much to all of you out there listening by this miracle of internet. Let me open the session, if I may, with prayer this morning. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for this miracle of technology and the talent that you've given to human beings to be able to discover it and also to operate it successfully for the benefit of communicating to our friends across the world the great truths of the meaning of life and salvation, the destiny of the world and our own destiny. We thank you for all of that. We praise you and glorify you for the talents of those who've helped us make all of this information available, thanking you particularly for Laurie, getting our translation out there online, and for many others who translate for us without any financial reward even, just out of the sheer goodness of their hearts. We praise you for all of that. We ask you to bless us now and those who listen, that we can interact intelligently with the chapter 8 in Hebrews, can make sense of it. We can learn to straighten out our thinking if it needs to be straightened out. Bring the day when the kingdom of God will fill the earth, when the earth will be full of the knowledge of God as the waters covered the sea. May that day come soon in view of the anarchy and the chaos we now experience all around us. We pray these things as we do every Sunday in and by the Spirit of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Okay. Thank you, Anthony. So we will return with Sir Anthony for the main sermon. It's Hebrews, the book of Hebrews, chapter 8. I hope my audio is good out there. I just noticed my audio settings a bit off. So, all right. Thanks, Tracy. Thumbs up there. Okay. So let's see. We will have, so what we do the mornings, in the Sunday mornings, we have a lot of teachings for you, actually. We have a youth lesson. I usually have a sermonette. So apologies if we throw too many teachings at you. And the apologies are due because we cannot answer all questions related to the teachings. I can only address questions to the main sermon, which in this case, we're going through the book of Hebrews, and Sir Anthony does the main sermon. We are on Hebrews 8, and here's actually a nice little meme my wife found, that she typed out, actually. And just to show you the previous, a nice summary of the previous chapters of this incredible book, which is all about how is it that this Jesus from the line of David, the tribe of Judah, can be the Jewish high priest? How is that possible? Because that breaks with the law of Moses that says that every priest had to come from a different family, a different tribe, the tribe of Levi. So this is a nice little summary. I put it in the chat if you're on the church chat. And if you'd like a copy of this, let me know. There's the email. But I think it's a very nice summary, and we have much, much more materials, many more things we can also share with you. So if you'd like any of those things, please let us know. But this is, I thought, a nice little summary of what has gone on before. But this morning, it'll be the great chapter 8. I mean, it just gets better and better. I mean, the book starts incredible, right? With incredible Christology, the incredible teaching of, sorry about that, my Zoom there is a bit off, an incredible teaching of who Christ is, who Christ was and is at the moment. So he is the Son of God. He is above the angels, Hebrews 1, right? It talks about how he's also called God. It's a reference to Psalm 45 in Hebrews 1:8. He's even the creator of the heavens and earth in what we believe is the world to come. Actually, that's what Hebrews 2 goes on to say. Hebrews 2:5 says it's the world to come of which we're speaking about. And God, the Father, has made his Son really the conduit of the new creation, if you will. So it's an incredibly exalted position. And, you know, you can understand why Jesus became associated with God in a very strict, literal way that we believe is wrong. but you can see where everything went wrong. And by the way, don't forget the Acts 17:11 rule. Do not believe anything we say. Check it out for yourself. Okay, so I'll bring up Tracy Z. This is her ministry page, by the way, KOG Missions. And she has also a store, a very nifty, cool store. You can click on and get all kinds of merchandise, clothes and other things, bags. And yeah, it's a very, very chock full website she has. So, all right. So I'll run a little intro Tracy did for her youth lesson this morning, and then I will bring her on.
Good morning, young people and those young at heart. In following Sarah's excellent teaching last week about running the race, and since the Olympics started this week, I thought we would keep on that same theme. As Christians, we are running a different race with different rules than the rest of the world. And even if we are temporarily a part of their races and their countries, we still give our sole allegiance to our king and not theirs, although we do obey and honor their king as we are commanded. Young people, think about your parents. When you behave and act respectful, people compliment you and your parents for raising such a good son or daughter. You need to bring that same praise to your heavenly Father, and this comes by the way you choose to live. Olympic athletes participating in the games represent their country of citizenship and should act respectfully so to bring honor to their country and not shame, just like Christians should bring honor to God's name. People are typically committed to their country where they are born or where they live, and especially if they're representing it in the Olympics. If you're on Germany's team, you don't wear a uniform for France or carry a flag from England. Your allegiance should be to your country. If you are proud of your country or if you're not proud of your country and you don't like your country, well, you can choose to not participate. Or you can always find another country, although you probably can't if you live somewhere like North Korea. But only you can only represent one country. Even if you have dual citizenship, you have to choose. Some countries don't even let you have dual citizenship. That means you're a citizen of both countries because they want your total allegiance. If you have dual citizenship, you would ultimately have to choose which country and which government you'll give your allegiance to. If they go to war, which side would you be on? If to cheer for a team in the Olympics, which colors would you wear to the game and which side of the stadium would you sit on? As the Bible tells us, you can't have two masters. You have to choose. The Bible also says that even though our citizenship is in heaven, and you can think of Jesus as holding our passports up in heaven, so to say, until he returns to either wake us up from the dead or change us and give us our documents so we can get into God's kingdom, which would be our immortality. The kingdom is the country, or actually the whole world, that he will rule and govern on behalf of his Father, and we get to help him. Even though our citizenship is in heaven for now, we must still live as kingdom citizens and follow God's rules and obey him today. One thing he tells us to do is to obey the rulers of the world, whether it is police officers, the government, teachers. In whatever country you live, you should be obeying those people who are running the country. And this, of course, only if they don't tell you to do things that would be contrary to what God says is right or wrong. We are told that this is for our own benefit so that we may live peaceful lives. If I don't speed on the road, I'm not going to have the police officer chasing me and giving me a ticket. And if you behave in school, you're not going to get sent to the principal's office or get detention. We are also told that this is so that we may silence the ignorance of foolish people by doing good. It says that in 1 Peter 2:15. If you choose to follow Jesus, then your allegiance must be to him and not to any particular country. He said that you must be willing to leave behind everything in this world in order to follow him. He said willing because you have a choice. Sometimes he will require you to leave things behind and give them up. And other times he'll let you keep them, but you must be willing to give them up in your heart and in your mind. I was an athlete long ago, and I was asked to leave that behind at one point in my life. And I don't regret that decision at all. The life I live in Christ and the hope that I have for God's kingdom and just being able to share that with people far exceeds anything sports or this world could ever offer me. Now, in saying this, I'm not saying that you can't participate in the Olympics if you're good enough or wear the uniform on a local team. You can still enjoy the freedom your country has to offer you. But you must remember, your allegiance is to God and to Jesus, not to a school or a team or a state or even a country. Of course, you should be loyal to your school or your state or your country if you're participating on their team. But if you're asked to do something that would go against God's rules, you must decline, even if it means you're kicked out of school or off the team or out of the country. Allegiance in the Bible means trusting and relying upon, whether it's a person or a thing. It is bold confidence in whom or in what you're giving your allegiance to. It's absolute trust. It also means to go after or follow. And if you swear your allegiance to something or someone, you are binding yourself to it, to them, especially taking an oath and saying that you'll obey and follow them. So again, you can only do this to one person or one thing. You cannot swear allegiance to God and to your country. You will love one and hate the other at some point, as it tells us in the Bible. Jesus even told us not to swear oaths. Our yes should mean yes and our no should mean no. We are told that our words are powerful and we will have to answer to Jesus for every word we speak. You can't say things flippantly and then think they don't have any meaning. If you pledge your allegiance to something other than to God, you are stating that you give your total allegiance to it. You can't only give part of it. So how does this apply to us in school or as an Olympic athlete? When I was an athlete or would attend events, out of respect for the country I was representing or living in, I would stand for their national anthem. We are told to honor the king and show respect. But I wouldn't sing their songs as if in agreement in what was being stated, because that is me saying that I agree. I would never pledge allegiance to a flag or a country because my allegiance was solely to God. We can only pledge allegiance to one king and to one kingdom, and it must be to God and to his kingdom. My children were never allowed to say the Pledge of Allegiance. You probably know kids who don't even know what that really means or what they're doing. I really personally think that it's early brainwashing, just like all the gender talk these days, like we talked about last time. And you don't want to be brainwashed. You're a lot smarter than that, I'm sure. Now, many states, they don't even want you to give your allegiance to your country anymore. They want your hearts and your minds given over to their sinful ideology and what they're teaching. A Christian should never put his trust in a worldly government or country. We cannot rely on them or give them our absolute trust. Only God is worthy of that. When you give your allegiance to something, you must have bold confidence in it because you are binding yourself by an oath. When you speak your words, it's an oath. Or you're making it your hope. But now we live in underworldly governments now, so what do? We must respect their authority and follow their laws, again, unless they go against God's laws. If we choose to participate in sports or other things, we should show loyalty to those teams because we're representing God as well in everything we do, even if we're playing a sport. If we shame the team, we bring shame on God by our actions. That is why your parents want you to behave in public. They don't want to be shamed by your bad behavior because it reflects on them. But in the end, you're really shaming yourself and God. You must always remember that the ultimate loyalty is to God. You obey your parents because you are obeying God. You follow the rules and the worldly laws because you are following Christ. So I'm going to end with a short, kind of funny story from Jeremiah. Jeremiah was told to get some new underpants and bury them in a hole. That's kind of odd, isn't it? But God was wanting to show him something. Later, he was told to go dig them out. When he took them out, they were dirty, ruined, and good for nothing, as you can imagine. You can imagine what they looked like or how they might have felt if you had to wear them. God told Jeremiah that this was an example of how he will ruin the wicked people who do not obey him and instead follow their own hearts and desires and give allegiance to other gods by worshiping and serving them. Have you ever said to your parents, or maybe just in your heart, I don't care what you say, I'm going to do what I want anyway? I'm sure your parents have heard you say that before, or your attitude and actions showed it. Or do you choose maybe to worship sinful movies or games by watching or playing them, even though you know Jesus wouldn't? Do you serve your friends by listening to what they say, even though you know it is not right in God's eyes? These are all ways we give our allegiance to other things, and are ways that we worship and serve other gods, and not our Father in heaven, who is the only true God. God told Jeremiah that he binds us close to him, like clean underwear, close to our bodies, and he intends for us to bring him fame, honor, and praise. But if we disobey him, we cannot. And we are then like that dirty, ruined underwear. I encourage you to be respectful of all people, starting with your parents, and then everyone in your schools and on your teams, whether they're adults or children. Be committed to whatever you choose to do, and do it as if unto the Lord. Unless, of course, something will take away your commitment to follow Jesus, then you need to obey him. And also, remember to keep your underwear clean. Thanks, Carlos.
Thank you, Tracy, for that much needed reminder of where our allegiance as Christians truly lies. And that's the Tracy's website ministry again, and check out her new store. So, yeah, this is a very important topic, Tracy, you touched on here, and it reminds me of what Paul says to the Romans in Romans 12 and 13. He says that actually the nations, the governments, are established by God himself, be they wicked or benign, by the way, as in good, quote-unquote good nations and evil nations. These are allowed by God. In a way, they're established by God. That's Romans 13. And as Tracy said, we have to pay allegiance to the state as far as we can. And one of the things that strikes me is what he says to Timothy in 1 Timothy 2. So as Tracy was saying, we have to respect, we have to honor the king at that time. Paul talks about the emperor and kings. But note why in verse 2, so that we Christians may lead a tranquil, peaceful life in all godliness and dignity. That's why we pay allegiance in a way, we honor in a way, the governments that sometimes turn evil and wicked, so that we may live peaceful lives and go about our work. And that is the work of the preaching of the gospel about the kingdom of God and the things regarding Jesus. In other words, we don't pay allegiance so that we join them, especially in the military or political system. I don't think that's what Paul meant. Again, so that we may, he gives you the reason there why. So also check out our ChristEnemyLove.com page, and please have a look at the history link there. I created a history of at least the first 400 or 500 years of the Christian movement that was nonviolent, apolitical. In other words, they were not into wars, into joining political positions. And they actually, the councils, the early so-called councils of the churches, actually had some very harsh punishments for people who called themselves Christians, converted to Christianity, but returned in a way to the world, to those systems. So thank you so much, Tracy. And let me get my 2 cents in here with my sermonette. And today I want to talk to you about begotten is made. So let's see if this works. Begotten is made. So you know the creeds, right? The old creeds. Jesus is begotten, not made, they say. But is that really true? So I compiled here a list of
verses, I believe, explicitly describe and show that the Son of God was created because he was begotten. And begotten is really an old antiquated English word that today in modern times is best, I believe, translated as procreated. You can hear the created word there, right? Procreated. In other words, generated. The Father generated the Son in Mary, in the womb. The Son, as a result, comes into existence, receives being. And I'll show you how Scripture explicitly says that. That is the language of biblical Scripture. And as a result, the Son has an origin. The Son originates in the womb of Mary. So here are your first texts. Luke 1:35, the Holy Spirit will come on you. This is the angel Gabriel to Mary. And the power of the Most High will overshadow you. For this reason, that is why, as a result, the Holy Begotten One, the child, will be called the Son of God. Matthew 1:20, pretty much the same thing is said to Joseph, and yet another angel of the Lord. Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is begotten in her is from the Holy Spirit. I want you to note this. Again, do not believe anything we say. Check it out for yourselves. But I want you to focus on the word there translated begotten in yellow. It is from the Greek verb yenao, which means to cause something to come into existence, primarily through procreation. Now, this is according to any standard Greek lexicon. Also, it means to generate, produce, to procreate. Again, you can check those lexicons out for yourself. You have the references right there. So the point is that both virgin accounts are describing the activity of God the Father in the creation of a new, unique human person, human being. Again, the verb yenao is actually used throughout the genealogies of both the Old Testament. So if you read the Old Testament Hebrew in the Septuagint or Greek translation, you will see how in the family trees, they have this word yenao in perhaps a different form, but the root verb is the same. And this is the same word used in the family tree of Jesus, when it says so-and-so begat so-and-so and so forth. So it refers to fathers begetting, procreating children. But most of your translations are hiding the action of God the Father, the one who creates, begets, generates this unique human son in the womb of Mary, by other words like born or conceived, as you can see there in this account, which all these words have to do with the action of the mother, not the father. For example, the mother obviously gives birth to you, and the mother also conceives the child. So the translations are not paying you well here with their what I believe are mistranslations, and perhaps on purpose to some extent, to hide the fact that the Son of God is created because he is begotten, procreated in the womb of Mary. Number two, the Son comes to be as a result. He comes into existence. And this is according to Paul himself, Galatians 4:4. He says, God sent forth his Son made of a woman. Again, note the word translated made, which is the Greek yenomenon, ek. Ek is the Greek saying basically, literally, out of a woman comes the Son, right? And the yenomenon word, once again, is the root Greek verb is that yenao word. Oh, sorry, not yenao, yinome, as you can see there. To come into being, existence, through the process of birth. That's what that word translated made denotes. To become, that is to come into existence, begin to be, receive being. And the sending language here by Paul, which has been twisted really by many scholars, which is unfortunate, should be understood then as a created commission, because send simply denotes a commission or a mission. So in other words, in the Old Testament, God sent forth Moses. God sent forth prophet Jeremiah, for example. Similarly, in the New Testament, in, for example, John 1, Mark 1, where you see John the Baptist, a man sent from God, it says. So it's really a created commission here. The famous German Jesuit priest and theologian Karl Rahner says this about that verse, Galatians 4:4. The Son's mission does not mean that the one sent existed as such before he was sent. In my view, the mission may imply the creation of the man, Jesus. That's exactly right. And this is repeated really by Paul in Romans 1 when he says that the Messiah came to be from the seed, that is, as a descendant of David. And we know this because Mary obviously was a Davidite. Mary was of the tribe of David, of the house of David, if you will. The last point here, as a result of all of this, obviously the Son has an origin. And that's, guess what? Exactly what the virgin birth account tells you. Explicit language, once again. This is an account of the origin, Genesis. We know that word very well from the book of Genesis, of Jesus the Messiah. Once again, in verse 18, the origin of Jesus happened this way. But again, your translations are not doing you a great service here. Note how this explicit Genesis word is really, in my eyes, mistranslated as either genealogy or birth, which really loses that origin sense that the virgin birth account clearly describes, where the Son originates because he was created, that is, begotten, procreated by God the Father. Again, the translators once again seem to hide the action of God the Father in the process of creation, in the act of creation, because God the Father here really is creating a new humanity, a new Adam, a new Genesis for humankind in general. As Doug Hare says in his book, and I like the way this writer puts it, not only was it referred to among Greek-speaking Jews, that is the Gospel of Matthew, as Genesis, but also his phrase, the book of the Genesis of Jesus Christ, is strongly reminiscent of the Greek version of Genesis 5:1, the book of the Genesis of human beings, and Genesis 2:4, the book of the Genesis of heaven and earth. In Jesus Christ, God had made a new beginning. To borrow from the language of Hollywood, the first gospel could be billed as Genesis 2, the sequel. I love that, right? So this is a new thing happening. This is why, by the way, Paul goes on to call the Son of God the second Adam, the second human being in the book of Romans and also to the letter to the Corinthians. But wait, there's more. The Son is called the firstborn of every creature in some translations. Now, this obviously implies that the human Son is part of the created order. Hence, Jesus can say in the book of John, in the Gospel of John, that he lives because of the Father. So once again, we see here that words like firstborn, by the way, when is God ever a firstborn? I mean, that's blasphemy to believe that God somehow can be called a firstborn, let alone a creature. So obviously, this verse is very interesting, very important, because it places the human Son of God in the sphere of creation. He is part of creation, But just because he has been made above creation, in other words, just because he is over creation, as in terms of authority over creation, doesn't mean the Son himself was not part of the created order. So to quickly summarize here, the human Son was created because he was miraculously begotten, that is, procreated by God the Father. Hence, the human Son received being, that is, he came into existence in the womb of his mother, like all of us human beings, but obviously in a unique, miraculous, special sense when it comes to the human Son of God. So, for the Apostle John, the Son is called monogenes, the only begotten. There is that word again, which I would translate as uniquely procreated. And that's that famous John 3:16, right? Now, the word monogenes is a compound word that is a word made up of two other words. So, from the Greek monos, you can hear the monotheism there, unique, only, and genes, which can mean kind, one of a kind. And again, this genes word can be traced back to the Greek verb genao. So the Father never procreated a non-human person, for example, an angel, because guess what? Angels cannot be monogenes. Angels are not only begotten. Now, that's not just because I'm saying that. You can read Hebrews 1:5. And by the way, Hebrews 5:1, this is a nice mnemonic memorization tool. Hebrews 1:5, to which of the angels did God the Father ever say, "You are my begotten Son. Today I have created you, begotten you." And Hebrews 5:1 says that priests, and that's what we're about to look into more here with Hebrews 8. Hebrews 5:1 says that all priests are chosen from among human persons, not non-human persons, that is, individuals. So, once again, you can find many articles related to this in one of our websites, and here's thehumanjesus.org. So, thanks for allowing me the time here to do this, and we will bring up Sir Anthony for his continuing of Hebrews. Thank you, Anthony.
Okay, that's crystal clear, wonderful. And if you find that intense, as it really was, and detailed, then you can listen to that over and over until you've taken in the full lesson. Very good summary of the fact that Jesus, in order to be the Messiah, must be a human being. He has to be descended from David. In the case of Jesus, of course, he was descended from David via his mother, who was of the family of David. God is not of the family of David, so his father could not affect that. But Jesus is the human Messiah, the son of David. And he did not pre-exist, because pre-existence is a fog word. Actually, doesn't mean anything. You cannot pre-exist yourself. You cannot be before you are. Every human being has to begin in the womb of his mother. And for Jesus to be human, he must be beginning. He must be generated. He must have his genesis, his origin, as Carlos pointed out so clearly, in the womb of his mother. And that's what you'll find clearly laid out in the New Testament. So I hope you'll find that very interesting. And you can go to further articles at our site, Focus on the Kingdom, and at Carlos's Human Jesus site. So soak your mind in these wonderful truths about the origin of Jesus. And this will do you good. It will unfog your brain. It will make you think clearly. It will improve your health even. Truth is valuable in every possible way. So now here we are in the 8th chapter of Hebrews, this magnificent book, 13 chapters. This is really a treatise. It's not so much a letter as a treatise, a very heavy, in the best sense, heavy, detailed, and thorough account of the Christian faith. I love the first verse here because it says, Now, the main point, I'm using a New American Standard version, doesn't matter. My translation is there online, which is far from perfect, but whatever it is, it will make the same points that I'm making. The main point of what has been said. So our writer is summarizing what he said in the first seven chapters. Wonderful, good teaching method. The main point of what has been said is this. We Christians have a high priest. That's very comforting to me. There's somebody on the job for us who worries about us, who cares about us, as in going into action on our behalf. We have a high priest. My point to you listening this morning would be, do you know who that high priest is? If you think that high priest is God himself, you haven't understood. So here's a chance to change your mind and get this straight. Because high priests have to be taken from men. That's what the Hebrews writer also says. Every high priest is appointed from men. So Jesus, if he's the high priest, has to be a man, otherwise he doesn't qualify. So don't go around saying Jesus is God. You're contradicting yourself, and much worse, you're contradicting the Bible. So the main point, and I cannot resist this main point concept, because at the very beginning of Hebrews, I want to remind you of this for your own teaching, the book of Hebrews made a fantastically interesting main point. The book of Hebrews begins by saying, in the past, in various ways, God spoke, God spoke, God spoke. He wasn't silent. But in these last days, he's spoken through a son. Most of the public doesn't understand this. They say, oh, well, we know Jesus died for our sins. That's right. It's not wrong. But the main point and the chief point is that God spoke in a son. He didn't just say, well, watch my son die on the cross. Important, of course, and essential as that is. So the main point in Hebrews chapter 2 was that the teaching of Jesus, the gospel preaching of Jesus, had its beginning. Carlos was talking about beginnings. Origins, beginnings are most important in the study of any subject. And Hebrews 2:3 had said, and it was the main point of what was said there, the main point there was the beginning of the gospel as Jesus preached it. Right there in Hebrews 2:3, it had its beginning. The Greek is even clearer than the English. It had its beginning. It did not have its beginning in the death of Jesus. It did not have its beginning in the resurrection of Jesus. It did not have its beginning at the second coming of Jesus, or even at Pentecost. It did not have its beginning at Pentecost. It had its beginning the moment Jesus opened his mouth and spoke. Do you remember that the voice said of Jesus in the ministry of Jesus, this is my son. For goodness sake, listen to him. And the history of the human race is this, that God has spoken constantly through prophets and other exponents of God's thinking, and we haven't listened. So the lesson for all of you listening today is, to what extent am I not listening to what the Bible says? Well, I may be claiming to do so. I may be paying even lip service to the Bible, but have I studied enough to know where I could be wrong? That is the most solid and interesting question you can ask yourself. So the main point, I'm back in Hebrews chapter 8 now, the main point of what has been said in the first seven chapters is that we have a human high priest. He has to be human, he has to be chosen from men. And he's taken his seat at the right hand of the throne of majesty. That's God, of course. The right hand of God in the heavens, not on the earth, but in the heavens. Now, that little phrase, taken his seat at the right hand, of course, for all of you who know your Bibles well, is a quotation and an allusion to Psalm 110, verse 1, where Jesus himself, and he, Jesus, the greatest of all teachers, quoted this verse to him, to the people, I should say, not to him. he quoted this verse, Psalm 110:1. Immediately after reciting the Shema in Mark 12, Jesus said, "Let me ask you a question now." Brilliant teacher as Jesus was, he said, "Let me talk to you now about this psalm. Why does the Bible say, 'The Lord said to my Lord,'" as Yahweh said to Ladoni, you can see that "to my Lord" there in Hebrew, Ladoni for our Hebrew speakers, "to my Lord, Yahweh said," okay, it's backwards here in that red translation, of course, because it's the exact order of the words, but the English is clearly, "Yahweh spoke or gave an oracle to my Lord." Now, the question is, who is that second Lord there? Oh, it must be God, you're going to say, because we know God is two or three persons. No, no, no. All you have to do is to know that that word Ladoni is not the word Adonai, which means Lord God, about 450 times in the Bible. It is not the word Adonai. Rather, it is the word Adoni. And let me give you this interesting fact, that all 195 occurrences of Adoni, not Adonai, but Adoni, never refer to God. So the one thing this verse cannot possibly say is, Yahweh sent an oracle to God. That would be blasphemous nonsense, creating two gods. So that Adoni word, you can remember it, your children should learn it early. Adoni means my Lord, human. It should not have a capital L. So in your Bible, take the capital L off that second Lord in Psalm 110:1. It's false and fake. It's misleading you. That's not God said to God. Now, recently we've discovered even leading scholars who have not bothered to read the Hebrew, don't know, and you know, if they're Greek scholars, they may not know much Hebrew. But the world needs to know on a grand scale, and we're going to say it Sunday after Sunday after Sunday, that the one sitting at the right hand of the Father, according to that Psalm 101, is not God, not deity. It's God speaking to an exalted, super exalted human being in Hebrew, Adoni. Check that with your Jewish speaking friends if you like. Don't believe a word I say, check it out. Actually, Strong's Concordance isn't necessarily adequate, but you can find it by searching the internet. That second word means not God. Adoni, all 195 occurrences of it. That's enough, surely, to give you the evidence you need. So that's the main point of what I want to say in 8:1 of Hebrews. Jesus has taken his seat. I'm comforted by this book. And it's been a great privilege to study it in detail for these lessons. That there's somebody on the job for us. There's somebody doing something for you as a Christian. He has a job to do, and that high priest is now seated next to God himself in heaven, and he's the My Lord, little L-O-R-D, of Psalm 110, verse 1. And this person in verse 2 of chapter 8, this person, this man, is a minister in the sanctuary and the true tabernacle, which the Lord, that's capital L, that's God, pitched, not man. You see the difference between Lord, God, and man. Not man. Man didn't pitch this super tent in heaven, if you like, the true tabernacle. And so Sarah's very useful list that Carlos earlier had up is very, very good, showing the comparison between the Levitical high priest and Jesus, our high priest. This is wonderful. I refer to that list, I think Carlos had it up there, a comparison of the Levitical high priest.
Yeah, sorry, I put a comment there. Yes, if anyone wants that meme, it's really a meme, a picture. Yeah. Let me know, I already sent one out, so.
Oh, good, it's wonderful.
Yeah.
Wonderful. I'll only comment on one of the comparisons that's given there. Looking at the left-hand column, it says, of the Levitical high priest, they taught the law of Moses. There it is. That's absolutely right. They taught the Torah of Moses. That's what you did as a Levite. That's what Moses taught. That's what Levites taught, the law of Moses. Now look at the corresponding one on the right there. But Jesus, our high priest, what did he do? He took away the first covenant. He established the second covenant. And it should say, and he taught the law of Messiah. Jesus was firstly a teacher. That's why 1 Timothy 6:3 says, be warned. If somebody doesn't come to you bringing the teaching of Jesus, you're being scammed. Now, I venture to suggest to you all out there this morning that the churches are largely scammed on this point. Many of them keep telling you that Jesus wasn't really a teacher. The whole point of Jesus, they say, is he died for your sins. That's not wrong. But it's only half of the truth. And half-truths are very great lies. I'll refer very briefly to an extraordinarily bad statement made by C.S. Lewis, the famous C.S. Lewis, who said, and I quote, he said, the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, are not the Gospel. That is fundamentally false. I hope that you're screaming when you hear that. The Gospels are not the Gospel, not the statement of Christian faith, but that's precisely what they are, because the teaching of Jesus is everything, 1 Timothy 6:3. The apostles warned us against scams and errors, and Carlos gave you a very good account of that dangerous mistranslation in regard to the origin of Jesus. But I'm giving you another one. Jesus and his teaching is everything. You must believe the teachings of Jesus firstly, and of course you then believe the teachings of Paul, who followed Jesus. Paul was a servant of Jesus. Paul did not contradict Jesus. He may have, and certainly did, develop some of the themes of Jesus in a more full way, in the book of Galatians particularly. So I want you to note then that that one item about the teaching of the law of Moses, the parallel should be Jesus took away the first and established the second, and Jesus taught the law of Messiah. So if you're still believing that Jesus only taught the law of Moses, you've got the wrong Jesus. You're driving on the wrong side of the road, actually. I'm trying to think of vivid ways of putting this to you, but it's simply wrong. Jesus taught the law of Messiah. That's who he was. He was the Messiah. And the law of Messiah is not, underlined 15 times, is not the same as the law of Moses. So if you're busy trying to keep the Sabbath meticulously, or trying to keep the holy days or the new moons meticulously, if you're busy trying to observe the food laws of the law of Moses meticulously, your genuineness and sincerity is unquestioned, but you're simply wrong. You need to give up the law of Moses and adopt the law of Messiah. So, in verse 3 of chapter 8, going on now with our wonderful description of this high priest, who is such a blessing because we need somebody to be working on our behalf, somebody who cares about us, somebody who's very concerned with our salvation. Well, you've got just such a person. Verse 3 says this, every high priest is appointed by God, that is, to offer gifts and sacrifices. There was a job to be done. God did this deliberately. Those Levitical priests, children of Aaron, actually, they had a very extensive job. They were offering sacrifices all the time for the people, and they had to offer them for themselves because they were sinners. They had a job to do, a very extensive and, I would think, exhausting job. And they were appointed to do this, it says in Hebrews 8:3. So it was necessary, of course, it would follow logically, that this high priest, that's Jesus, our one and only high priest, also has something to offer. And you say, well, what could that be? Did Jesus go around offering sacrifices day after day? Well, no. He offered himself. So that is a stupendously great truth mentioned right there. It was necessary in God's great plan, Hebrews 8:3, that this new high priest, Jesus Messiah, our high priest, also had something to offer. I'll refer you then on that subject to Isaiah 53, which is all about the suffering servant. These apostles often quoted or alluded to the Old Testament. They didn't always give you the verse, but we can do it with the benefit of all the tools we have these days. In Isaiah 53, you'll find that the servant Jesus Christ, the high priest, in verse 11 of Isaiah 53. I'll go back to verse 10. It says that Yahweh, all caps, L-O-R-D, that's the Lord God, the one Lord God, was pleased to crush him, the Messiah. Wasn't pleased. God wasn't thrilled about creating difficulty. It doesn't mean that. It was in God's great plan that he crushed Jesus, putting him to grief. If he, the Son of God, would be willing to render himself as a guilt offering. Ah, I see. This super high priest, Jesus, did have something to offer, namely himself. He offered himself as a guilt offering. And when he does that, he will have the joy of seeing his offspring, the products of his gospel of the kingdom, and he will prolong his days. I would think so. Jesus is prolonging his days for eternity. He's indestructible. That's comforting. And the good pleasure, the delightful thing that God's doing, will prosper in his, the Messiah's, hand. Verse 11 of Isaiah 53. This is just good background commentary on the section in Hebrews that we're reading. As a result of the anguish of his soul, Jesus went through anguish on your behalf. He allowed nails to be driven through his wrists or hands, and he suffered for those many hours on the cross at the hands of wicked people on your behalf. As a result of the anguish of his soul, I'm in Isaiah 53:11, he, the Messiah, will see it and he'll be satisfied. He will see that it was worth going through all of that suffering. And then a verse that is very little used but ought to be used by everybody: by his knowledge, the righteous one, the Messiah, my servant. So Jesus is the ultimate servant of God. How does he make people right? That word justify is an easy word. It simply means to make people who are wrong right. You know about justifying a right-hand edge of a margin. You make it straight. How does he do it? By his knowledge. Mistranslated in the NIV very badly, it says the knowledge of him. No, no, no. His knowledge, meaning the knowledge that he had. So Jesus is trying to make us right rather than wrong, to make us straight rather than crooked, by his knowledge, his teaching, his instruction, namely the law of Messiah, not the law of Moses. So in verse 12 says, he actually bears their iniquities. We know that. We know what that means. He bore our sins on the cross on our behalf. Therefore, in response to that, here's what God has chosen to do. I, God here, will be speaking, will allot him, will give him a portion with the great. I would think so. Jesus is the greatest human being ever to have lived. John the Baptist was close by, but not as great as Jesus, but still a very great human being. Jesus is the greatest of all because he's now currently at the right hand of the Father in the heavens. And he will divide the booty with the strong. That's a triumphant and majestic position to have. Why? Because he, Jesus, poured out himself to death. That's what the Hebrews writer has in mind here. He was numbered with the transgressors, just counted as a common criminal, Jesus was, on your behalf. And yet, what we didn't fully realize, but we do now, we Christians can realize, is that he himself bore the sin, bore the sin of many, bore the sin of many. He took your sins on himself. He was killed in your place so that you didn't have to die. And then he interceded for the transgressors. That's another great point that we're coming to in Hebrews 8. Not only did Jesus die for you, so that you didn't have to die ultimately, but he also pleads with God for you right now. That's a comforting thought back there in Hebrews 8, our section for the morning. Let's see what else we have here by way of treasures of understanding in Hebrews 8. If you were on earth, it says in verse 4, if Jesus were on earth, which he's not, he's now at the right hand, he wouldn't even be a priest. Isn't that striking? Since there are those priests on earth, they would be Levitical priests, Aaronite priests, the word when the writer was writing. They are daily offering gifts according to the Torah of Moses, the law of Moses. And these people, as they were in the day when the writer was writing, they serve as a sketch. Now, note that word copy and shadow. The meaning is a sketch, an impression, a rough outline, but not the real thing. A shadow is a very flimsy version of the real thing. The thing itself has substance and reality in a way the shadow doesn't have. So God was teaching this lesson about what Jesus was going to do by giving us that Levitical system, offering sacrifices day by day, year after year, especially on the Day of Atonement, as a sketch, as a lesson, as an outline, a rough outline of the reality that hadn't then come, but has now come. So they carry out then, it says in verse 5, a copy and a shadow of the heavenly things, the things that are ultimate now in heaven. Just as Moses, the law of Moses, and Moses was warned by God, and he was told to erect the tabernacle in the days of Moses, and God said to him, look, see that you make everything according to the pattern, the model, the sketch which was shown you on the mountain. So God was mercifully educating his people with a view to the great Messiah who was one day going to come. And we are blessed enough to live beyond those days. The Messiah has been now, 2,000 years since he came. So we can look at all of this in retrospect. And our writer to Hebrews helps us to put it all in perspective. Now, look at the logic in verse 7. If that first covenant, the first covenant, so there must be more than one, there are two. If that first covenant of Moses had been faultless, there would have been no need for a second covenant. How logical that is. If everything had gone smoothly and everybody had listened to what Moses said carefully and done it and successfully carried out everything Moses said, there'd be no need for a second covenant. But that wasn't the case, because in verse 8, God, and we might have predicted this, found fault with them. He didn't find fault with his own covenant. There was nothing wrong with the covenant in itself. But the fault was with the people. So that's what it says in verse 8. Finding fault with those Israelite people who did not carry out the law of Moses properly, God then says...
Anthony?
Yes.
What do we got? Sorry. I'll give your voice a rest and give you time to have a sip of water there. I'll read the prophecy here by Jeremiah. It's the longest Old Testament quote, by the way, by the New Testament writers. So it's very, very important. Look, the days are coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their fathers on the day when I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt, because they did not continue in my covenant, and I had no regard for them, says the Lord. It, that covenant, will not be like the covenant that I made with their fathers on the day when I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt, because they did not continue in my covenant, and I had no regard for them, says the Lord. And each one will not teach his fellow citizen or his brother, saying, know the Lord, because all will know me, from their least to their greatest. And each one will not teach his fellow citizen or his brother, saying, know the Lord, because all will know me from their... And when he said... by the way, we do have some mistakes on this online translation, so please let us know when that happens. Verse 13, when he said a new covenant, he made the first obsolete, and what is becoming obsolete and growing old is near to disappearing. Go ahead, Ant.
Yeah, that's the longest quotation, I think, from the old and the new. This has got to be highly significant. A whole history of the law of Moses and the failure, because of the people's failure, the failure of God to speak successfully through the law of Moses. It didn't work because the people were not paying attention. The danger for all of us is we follow the bad example of those people, because our tendency as human beings is to get things wrong. Give us half a chance to get it wrong and we will. That's why we need teachers. We need the Bible to constantly correct us. That's what's being worked at here. So that's a massively long quotation. It ends in verse 12 of Hebrews 8. I will be merciful to their iniquities, and I will remember their sins no more. Isn't that a blessed end point of that prophecy? In verse 13, when he said, a new covenant, he has made the first one obsolete. Is that clear? The old covenant is obsolete. It was about to disappear even when that prophecy was written, by the way. It didn't just disappear in 70 AD. It disappeared as soon as that prophecy was made. Commentators will point that out. So that is long obsolete. What is not obsolete is the new Torah of Messiah. We were shocked the other day because Carlos was debating with somebody about the Torah of Messiah as distinct from the Torah of Moses. And the person who apparently was supposed to be expert in the subject said, what's the Torah of Messiah? What? The Torah of Messiah is the teaching of Jesus. So look carefully at what's being taught in your own church. Is it clear that the Jesus that you're being instructed on week by week is really the Torah of Messiah? Is it really his teaching, or are you getting a dangerous Torah of Moses dressed up as Christianity? I remind you of the very chilling quotation of Jesus, where he says, why do you call me Lord, Lord, but you refuse to do what I teach? Jesus saw that problem coming. Our tendency is to say, oh, I accept Jesus. But what you really mean by that is I accept his death, but you don't accept his teaching. So the book of Hebrews is a wonderful remedy to any tendency to get the covenants mixed up or muddled. Ask your pastor to preach to you on the difference between the Torah of Messiah, the new covenant that is, and the old covenant. And if you have any hankering after keeping food laws, observing the Sabbath on Saturday, you're in the wrong covenant. Not doing you any good. You're driving on the wrong side of the road, I might suggest. Okay, we need to do some more comments, I think.
Yeah.
On this chapter 8. What have we got?
Yeah, we got some questions here.
Yes. Let's see what we have.
Does the prophecy of Jeremiah, the new covenant, foretell that God would get rid of the commandments or put the commandments on the hearts of the Israelites rather than on stone?
Well, both things. Certainly, the commandments are to be written on our hearts, but it's not the same commandments. The Torah of Moses is not the same as the Torah of Messiah. the new covenant has new teachings. So let's go through that point. It's a very good question from David there. Jesus himself said, you've heard that Moses said, you can have a divorce for whatever reason that was in Deuteronomy. Jesus said that. You've read that Moses said, you can have a divorce. But I'm saying something different. Is that clear? In Matthew 19, Jesus contradicts, modifies, changes the law of Moses on that point. When accused of breaking the Sabbath, Jesus said, haven't you read what even the priests did in Old Testament times? The priests are not bound by Sabbath keeping when they're working in the temple. And guess what? Jesus is working in the spiritual temple, and so should you be too. You are not bound by the Sabbath. And then Paul came along and strengthened, clarified, and amplified that same teaching because Jesus was being followed by Paul. Paul echoed, reinforced, underlined the teaching of Jesus about the Sabbath when Paul said in Colossians 2:16 and 17, Sabbath, holy days, and new moons are a shadow. There's that wonderful word shadow. Don't try to keep the shadow when the substance has come. If you insist on the shadow, you're denying the substance. You're saying, Jesus, I don't think you really count because I'm going to keep those laws of the Old Testament. Don't do that. That's driving on the wrong side of the road, I suggest. So I hope that deals with that question there. The commandments are changed because the Torah of Moses is not the same as the Torah of Jesus.
Another one, is the administration then of the covenants different, or are the covenants different? So what exactly is different?
Well, both things. Both things are true. It's true that there's a new writing on the heart. That's brand new. But the content of the covenant is different. Otherwise, Jesus could not have said, Moses said, but I say to you. Jesus could not have said, we don't have to pay the temple tax. What? The Bible said they had to pay the temple tax, but said Jesus said we don't have to keep it. Now, we'll do it to keep them happy. That's a different issue. We'll do it for diplomatic reasons, but we don't have to keep it. So the teaching of Jesus is different in many respects, particularly in terms of Sabbath keeping, holy days, and new moons. They are not the same. So both things, I think, in answer to David's good question there, both things are true. The administration, it's administered in a different way, if by that you mean it's written on the heart, not just externally. And the commandments are in some ways different, not always different. Loving your neighbor is an Old Testament idea, so is a new. Paul talked about not muzzling the ox when it's working. He was quoting the Old Testament. There's plenty of good principles in the Proverbs, in the law of Moses too, which are absolutely binding on us today. Nobody would question that. But there are substantial, central law of Moses things, which Paul calls the works of the law. He names them the works of the law. They are going to kill you. You cannot have Jesus and his covenant at the same time as what Paul calls the works of the law, Sabbath keeping, holy days, new moons, Jewish roots stuff, if you like. Don't want to do that. If you do that, you're losing out on Jesus. You're driving on the right side, on the wrong side of the road. You want to do that. Yeah.
Question here about your translation, Anthony.
Yeah.
Verse 6, you have there, now Jesus has obtained a superior ministry. Yes. Since he's also the mediator of a better covenant,
yes,
which has been given as law,
yes,
based on better promises.
Yes.
Now, most translations don't render the Greek that way. So yeah, they have things like the new covenant is established on better promises,
yeah,
as you see. So they don't have that reference to the law.
Right.
Now, so let me ask you, you base yeah that as you have explained to me on yep this rather long yep Greek word. So
yes,
can you explain that word and the meaning behind it and why you opted for
it? Absolutely. I did it quite deliberately because that long Greek word, the nenomothetite, the word nomos is right there. It's been entored on better promises. So it's still Torah. Absolutely. Jesus gave the Torah of Messiah. So that is why I deliberately did that. It's been given as law, but a new law. The law of Messiah. I think we should turn to 1 Corinthians 9.
Well, before that, Anthony, I'm noticing here the cross-reference by the Bible Hub people.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You see there in Hebrews 7:11?
Yeah.
The people received the law?
Yeah.
So it's that same nenomotheti word, yes. Which is interesting. So
yes,
they do have it there.
Okay, well, that's good. If somebody's looking at that, it's absolutely true. The people received the law, and the law of Messiah is in Torah. The English word would be entored, E-N-T-O-R-A-H-E-D, entored, made law based on better promises.
Right, so now Christians received a new law, a better law. So absolutely. Is it proper to say that as a result of Christ, obtaining a ministry which is better, it says, much more excellent than the old covenant ministry. So now he mediates a better one.
Yes.
And since that's the case, therefore it's enacted on a better law, a better legislation.
Oh, absolutely, of course. That's what I tried to get that point over in my translation. It's still Torah, but it's not the Torah of Moses. The fatal danger is to confuse the Torah of Moses with the Torah of Messiah. So can we go to 1 Corinthians 10, 9, rather, 20, and look at that?
1 Corinthians 9.
Yes.
Yep. 1 Corinthians 9.
This solves everything. 1 Corinthians 9, you've got it there.
Yep, so this is Paul to the Corinthians.
Yes.
And if you can see it there.
All right. To the Jews, these texts are absolutely staggeringly important. To the Jews, Paul said, I became like a Jew so that I might win Jews. Then he explains himself meticulously. To those Jews who are under the law, I, Paul, became like someone under the law, even though I myself, Paul, as a Jew and follower of Jesus, I'm not under the law. That is a dramatically important text. Don't let anybody tell you that the Greek says something different. It doesn't. It's very easy. Paul is a model Christian. Paul is by inheritance, by genealogy, a Jew, and he is not under the Jewish law of works. But he's willing to compromise and be diplomatic to win people who are under that law of Moses. Then he goes on. He's very meticulous with his language here in 21. To those who are without the law, that's to say non-Jewish people, they didn't have the law of Moses, I became like one without the law. I didn't fuss with Sabbath keeping, holy days, food laws, all that, if I'm talking to non-Jewish people. Then he very carefully has to modify what he says there. Not myself, Paul speaking, I myself am not without the law of God. In other words, if I say I'm not under the law, it doesn't mean I have no law of God. Of course not. That would be impossible. But within the law of Messiah. There it is precisely. This is a legal document. The words are absolutely unarguable, logically impeccable. I, Paul, am not without the law of God, of course not, but I'm within, or we might even say under, the law of Messiah. There it is. 21 of 1 Corinthians 9 will solve a multitude of problems.
Let me now ask you.
Yeah.
Actually, it's not a question, but
you're going to make a statement. All right.
Yeah. Let me share. You talked about the verse 13 there.
Yeah.
About when he said a new covenant.
Yeah.
By the way, when he said that means God in the prophet Jeremiah.
Right.
So we're going way back to the Old Testament.
Yes.
So this is, you know, a new covenant, he has made the first obsolete. So I just wanted to share here I think you mentioned that commentaries are actually very good on this. So let me go down here. So this is Bible Hub. You can check this out for yourself. And under Pulpit Commentary, which is one of the best known commentaries, You see this regarding verse 13, sorry. Let me go to verse 13. So it says, he hath made the first old, refers to the time of Jeremiah's prophecy, not of the writing of the epistle. Now, this is very important for the case this commentary will go on to make. The very mention of a new covenant had even then, okay, then at Old Testament times, antiquated the other. It survived only under the category of old as opposed to new, and further marked with the growing decrepitude, that is oldness, getting old, which is the precursor of dissolution. So, and then it goes on to say here, let's see, when the epistle, if you see there, when the epistle was written, it would not have been spoken of as waxing old, but as defunct. The temple indeed was still standing with the old ritual going on, but it had become but as the stately shrine of a lifeless thing. I think that's spot on, Anthony. What do you reckon?
No, I think that's absolutely right. And that's an extremely important point. What we're trying to get over here from the 8th chapter of Hebrews is that the new covenant is new. It is different from the old. And there are a whole lot of claiming believers out there who are, so to speak, driving on the wrong side of the road. They haven't seen that Jesus is the model of the new covenant teaching. He is not, I repeat, not modeling the law of Moses in the letter. We could spend the whole book of Galatians, maybe we should get to that when we finish Hebrews, and go through Galatians, which is devastatingly clear that that law of Moses was defunct. It was decrepit even when Jeremiah said those words. So I'm so glad that you found that quotation in the pulpit commentary. I hadn't seen that, but that simply makes our point for us. That's wonderful.
Yeah, another point here, Anthony, is if you can speak to this. So yep. In Hebrews 8, verse 4.
Yes.
If he, that is the Messiah Jesus,
yes,
if he were on earth, he would not be a priest.
Yes.
Now, someone recently who's unfortunately has a sort of big following on YouTube said that proves to them that Jesus was not a high priest on earth until his ascension.
Ah, okay.
It says there, if he were on earth, he would not be a priest. What do you say to that sort of?
Well, no, he became a priest the moment he opened his mouth. That's shown by Hebrews 9:11. He showed up as high priest. He didn't become high priest after his death. The voice from heaven said, while Jesus was on earth preaching in the days of his flesh, as the book of Hebrews says, it says, this is my son, listen to him. It didn't say, listen to him, but don't listen to him till after he dies. Come on. That's very clear. When he showed up, when he came, when he arrived as high priest of the good things that are now already here, there's a variant there, either the good things that are coming or the things that have already come. Both would be true. There is a sense in which those good things have begun to come even now. He went through the greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with human hands, that's to say, not part of this creation. He's working, of course, prior to his death there. But so I disagree with the idea that he didn't do anything essential until he died. His death is right. Essential, but it's not the point at which he became the high priest.
Right. Well, the verse here in verse 4 goes on to say, for those priests on earth offer gifts according to the law.
Of course they did.
That is the law of Moses.
Of course, the law of Moses.
But because Jesus was not a high priest according to Torah, the law of Moses.
Yes.
He could not be a priest according to that order. That's how I'm understanding that verse.
Of course he
could. So, in other words, as you said in one of the last Sunday sentences, you said that would mean that Jesus is not a Mosaic high priest I think
of course he's not. And the reason for that is going to be given in the book of Hebrews. Wrong tribe. Jesus was not from the Levitical tribe. You have to be of the people of Levi and of Aaron to be a priest. So that is exactly what's said here in that beautiful verse that you pointed to. If he were on earth, he would not be a priest at all. Why? Because all the priests had to come from the tribe of Levi. And guess what? Jesus was from the tribe of Judah. That's what makes him so special and so new. He's a royal Davidite, Jewish, Davidic person genealogically. He absolutely is disqualified at any point from being a Levitical priest. That should tell you the difference between the law of Moses and the law of Messiah.
Well, that should also tell us, Anthony, if you're a self-professed follower of the Messiah,
yes,
right, that should tell you that if the Messiah himself is outside the Torah, he's disqualified by Torah himself.
Yes.
Why are you trying to go back to the yoke?
Yes.
As Paul calls it, as James calls it, not for Anthony, not Carlos.
That's right.
The burden, as the Lord's brother himself in Acts 15 says, the law was a burden to our ancestors.
Yes.
We should not burden them, that is Gentiles, any further. That's so ask yourself, as someone who confesses Jesus as your Lord, right? If he's outside the law of Moses, if he himself is not observing Torah at that point, why are you?
You're trying to outdo Jesus. You're trying to be better than Jesus. Don't recommend that. So the strongest text I like that makes the point so clear to me, Paul said in Galatians, and the whole book of Galatians should be reread in the light of what we're saying. He said, if I was still teaching circumcision, which was absolutely commanded for Jew and Gentile alike under the Torah of Moses, every Jew and Gentile who wanted to be part of the covenant under Moses had to be physically circumcised. Paul was absolutely against any compulsory physical circumcision. And he says in a moment of passion in his argument in Galatians, if I were still preaching what Moses preached in Genesis 19, that circumcision of the flesh is binding on everybody who wants to be in the covenant, if I were doing that, which I am not, why am I being persecuted? Paul was willing to be suffering, persecuted by the Jewish roots element of his day, and we're fighting the same thing today. We must be clear about the law of Moses not being the same as the law of Messiah.
Yeah, furthermore, in the prophecy, Anthony, if you go back to it, the Jeremiah prophecy here quoted extensively explicitly says in, I believe, verse 10, if you can see that.
Yes.
The covenant, this covenant called the new covenant, what's it say? Will not be like the covenant. Can you speak to the language of first and second better and not?
Oh, of course we need. Yes, exactly right. The writer is going to great lengths to say that no, the old covenant is not the same as the new. Verse 9, not like the covenant, unlike, different from. How clear does it get? So let us not ever run the risk of mixing the covenants, of driving on the wrong side of the road. It's certainly right to drive on the left in England, but I don't recommend you drive on the left in America. Don't confuse such an elementary thing. I would simply say this error is more widely spread among Bible-believing people who insist, they try to insist that Jesus was really just a repeat of Moses. That is fundamentally flawed and wrong.
And again, verse 7, as you said, for if that first covenant, then there would be no need for, guess what?
A second
covenant. Again, if Jesus simply came to parrot, to repeat Moses,
absolutely,
to live under the old covenant, to continue that, and so are the apostles supposed to do that, then at that point, language, as we have said, Anthony, loses any meaning, any understanding.
It does. I think so. I'm glad we had time to spend on this chapter.
Yeah, let me put a couple of comments for you to comment on, if you don't mind.
No, and I love that.
I think we'll continue with chapter 9 next time.
I think so.
As time is fleeting.
Absolutely.
But could you comment on Kingdom of God ministry and missions? Jesus did not abolish the laws, but perfected them. The standard is much higher now for believers.
Yes, that's certainly true. And there are cases in which he actually abolished the law, perfecting the law. And that point about divorce, he changed it. He abolished it. I'm saying, no, Moses was not right for you. Moses allowed you to divorce for whatever reason that was. But I'm contradicting that now. So putting a higher standard sometimes means getting rid of the lower standard. So that's absolutely right.
Let's see another comment here, if I can find it. Yes, so this is from Matt Sakra. This is very interesting. Yeah. This is one of the Jewish commentaries, Nida 61.
Yes.
That is to say that the mitzvot will be nullified in the future, a mixing mitzvot or commandment. What do you say to that?
Well, that's that even the rabbis understood this. They said that the law of Messiah, when it finally comes to perfection, will make all the earlier attempts at law nothing by comparison. The mitzvot, the commandments, will be nullified in the future. Right. I don't know what that thing in square brackets exactly means there, but the rabbis themselves, they had a very solid tradition that in the future, when the Messiah rules in his future kingdom, then all of the commandments will be less than they will be at that future time, the law of Messiah. So they had this grand and correct idea.
Right.
Yes.
Another comment from David. It feels to me that the phrase law of Moses is used to downplay it.
Yes.
If we say the law of Yahweh, it doesn't carry the same implications. What do you mean?
Well, Paul uses that phrase, God's law. He says, I'm not without law, but I'm not under the law of Moses. The law of Moses is certainly often and utterly clear. It's the teachings of Moses. And we shouldn't refer to the law of Moses unless we're very clear that that's not what we're trying to keep today. The law of Yahweh is absolutely standard. You cannot have any sort of Christian obedience. So you balance all of these conversations by Hebrews 5:9, which says that salvation is given to those who obey Jesus. If only we would use the word obey all the time, we should say to people, will you please obey Jesus? Not just will you please accept him. It's too vague. The language is too foggy, not clear. It isn't real solid language, but the law of Yahweh is certainly what we're under. The law of Yahweh is everything, provided you realize what dispensation we are living in. And we're living in the post-Jesus dispensation. And so his Torah of Messiah, which is a phrase used several times in the New Testament, that Paul himself said that the law of Messiah means you're to do to your neighbor what you want done to yourself. That's straight out of the law of God in the Old Testament, if you like. So there's an overlap. But what is fatal is trying to keep the signs of the old covenant. What you're telling God is, I don't like the new covenant. I'm going to stay with the old covenant. I prefer the old to the new. That is not recommended.
Yeah, this is an interesting thing I have found in my debates with people who hold to the Torah or try to, that they somehow say, stop using that phrase because it sounds like you are using it in a derogatory way, I think I was accused of. Well, the phrase does appear 20 plus times in Scripture.
Which one? Which
the Law of Moses. Here. So, for example, Philip found Nathanael. Hey, we have found the one Moses wrote about in the law. Well, wait a minute. I thought it was the law of God. Well, of course they know it's the law of God. That's like saying, well, maybe we should modify language and not talk about the law of Messiah as if Messiah came up with the law. Although I guess since most people believe Jesus is God, they wouldn't have an issue with that. But of course, the law of Moses, they understood as the law of God himself. Again, the passage in Matthew 19 that you reference about marriage and divorce. I mean, Jesus himself says, well, Moses permitted you. Well, was it Moses or was it God? Well, obviously, Jesus understood.
Moses.
It's just very frustrating. And
it is. Not difficult. But I'm so glad that Matt Sankara and these other good questioners are very welcome, by the way. David Brachetto, though.
Yeah.
Very welcome questions.
One last one from David. Was David, King David, breaking the Torah when he put on the ephod and offered sacrifices in 2 Samuel 6 and 24?
Well, no, I think Jesus said that is not so. David, in fact, did things that only priests could do. So strictly speaking, he was breaking the law. He was actually, the priests were breaking the Sabbath. That's the language of Jesus now. Jesus commenting on what the Levitical priests did. Jesus said they broke the Sabbath when working in the temple. So Sabbath keeping was not binding upon a priest when he worked in the temple. How much less is Sabbath keeping binding in the new covenant? Good point.
So there is the reference about David and his companions, Matthew 12:3. Have you not read? So Jesus pleads from a couple of exceptions, okay? Not the rule. Exemptions are not the rule. But the interesting thing here, Anthony, is that Jesus makes two old covenant, old law exceptions, the rule. So he takes this exception of David and his companions and the priest in the temple, right? Have you not read? Look at verse 5. In the law, on the Sabbath, in the temple, they break the Sabbath, yet are innocent. These were exceptions under the old system, but Jesus makes now the exception the rule, and he goes on to explain why in verse 8, for the Son of Man, that is the human being, is now Lord of the Sabbath. In other words, he owns it now, and he can do with the Sabbath what he wants. Do you want to have a day of rest? By the way, it doesn't have to be Friday evening, Saturday. Do you have to? Yes, sure. Take it whenever you want. Do you want to work on the Sabbath day as he does in John 5, by the way? Just quickly here in John 5, he's accused once again of breaking the Sabbath. And Jesus doesn't say, no, I'm not breaking the Sabbath. Note what he says, Jesus. Truly I say, the Son can do nothing by himself. For whatever the Father does, the Son also does. So just as the Father to this very day in verse 17, look at that, is working, so I am working.
Yep. New covenant, Torah of Messiah.
All right. So thanks, good. Anthony, and we'll continue.
Yeah, we appreciate the interaction very much from our listeners. Very much appreciated.
Yes, good questions there. Thanks, everyone. Apologies if I did not get to your questions. We have run out of time here. So we will be back with Hebrews chapter 9. And let's see, a couple of announcements before we leave. I have a live conversation you can follow if you're on the live stream chat. You can follow it here. Back to Genesis. So this is with author Greg Dybul. If you know about Greg, this is his book. They Never Told Me This in Church. And we'll talk about an article he posted. And if you go to the link, you'll see his article. So we'll talk about going back to Genesis. So this is a conversation on very important subject of transgenderism and male and females nowadays and all that. I think he wrote a very important treatise, and I'd like to talk to him about it, and you will have a chance to ask us questions about this very important subject dealing with homosexuality in the church and male female gender roles and all this stuff nowadays about, you know, men who feel like becoming a woman or feel like a woman, therefore they can even compete in the Olympics. There's a man competing at the moment in the Olympics because he feels like a woman. Anyway, So we will deal with this very, very touchy subject. This Wednesday, and those are Eastern Standard Times, by the way, New York time, Eastern Coast, East Coast of the U.S. time. So hope you can be with us for that. Some quick comments here we get from YouTube about my talk on Yahweh Text to Jesus against Dr. Capes. Very good one. You nailed it, brother. Thank you. That's our friend in the UK. Back to Biblical Faith is the name of his channel if you want to check it out. On the video, what does the kingdom of God is at hand coming soon mean? I wish I had learned this instead of the orthodoxy I grew up with that never thought of the kingdom as anything too important. Yet there it is before me. Every time I read in the Gospels, Jesus is always talking about the kingdom. That's right. And let's see a couple more on one of Tracy's youth lessons, what it means to become a Christian. This woman, Tracy, mops the floor with most men in this world. Easy. Wow. That's quite a compliment. And I probably would have to agree with that very much. Let's see. Matthew 28:19. Is it a Trinitarian corruption? Thank you for your explanation. For more info about the topic, as I was a person probably influenced by this controversy of Eusebius, and if you want to know what the commenters talk about, check out that video. When I started considering the verse as corrupted, so I don't know if you can see there, but that's Dan Gill, and I always use Pastor Dan Gill of Higher Ground Church in Tennessee, White House, by the way. Matthew 28:19, neither Trinitarian nor a formula. I love that. So very simply put. Okay, so we will close with prayer. Thanks again, everyone out there, for watching. Please pray for our family here, our church family, the Coxes, Michelle and Tom, getting better from a little bout of illness. Continued prayers for people around the world with the continued pandemic, people especially in so-called third world countries. We have many brothers and sisters in Peru, in Colombia, in South America, and all those places. For pastor there, Edwin, and in my home country, Nicaragua, with Alex and the people there. So please keep them in your prayers. Father, we thank you so much for the peace and comfort and relative wealth, really, we have here in this country. We pray for the leaders. We pray for the stability to continue in all these nations, all these lockdowns and governments prohibiting freedom of people to even go to work. Father, we ask you to please forgive us our trespass and forgive these leaders any actions that will lead to violent consequences. And you know things, Father, you establish them, you tear them down. But we simply just ask for your mercy. You are the potter. We are the clay, Father. We understand this. So sometimes things are difficult to understand, the so-called problem of evil. But all we can do is hope and pray on the coming of your kingdom. And we pray that our courage and faith remain steadfast during these hard times. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless. Until we meet again.